have your Bibles, would you please turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6? This morning we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 8. Now, we've had a very, very, power-packed time in the book of 1 Corinthians thus far, but I'm excited to be back in our verse-by-verse study through God's Word after our Christmas season and our New Year and Vision Sunday studies. But by way of recap, in this letter that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, he's addressing major issues that are in the church, things that were going on in the church that needed to be dealt with. Very, very instructional, this letter. It's something that we even are, we should be, that we're instructed with today as well as a church of what to do and what not to do. Those issues that are addressed on how they can be corrected and by which we're instructed on such matters that we face as a church in general, the church abroad, if you will. Two of the issues that Paul has already addressed were divisions in the church, and we saw some very, very practical instruction on how to deal with potential splits in church or the church dividing, how to handle such things when people say, well, I follow this guy and I follow that guy and you don't know what you're talking about. No, you don't know. We're better, you're better. No, he says we're the body of Christ. Did Paul die for you? Was Apollos or Cephas crucified for you? You know, these are the things that Paul was dealing with, divisions in the church. And we learned how we're the one body of Christ. We also, in our last study, we saw Paul address the lack of church discipline in dealing with sin. And this was very uncomfortable. And part of going verse by verse through the Bible, you deal with the things that are uncomfortable and you deal with the things that are comfortable. If we have a tendency, and I'm hoping and praying because that's not our DNA, but if we were a church that would only teach thematic messages or topical messages, which there's nothing wrong with doing those things from time to time, I do them myself, but we would be inclined, and what can happen is that if I come to a passage of Scripture where I'm looking at it and I can teach one thing that's very uncomfortable, or I can teach another thing that actually I think my audience would receive better, I would naturally want to do the thing that, or teach the study that would be received best by the audience. And you can fall into a dangerous spot of teaching things that you know your people want to hear as opposed to teaching what God wants His people to hear, which is the entire counsel of God. And so the last study that we had in 1 Corinthians, especially in chapter 5, we dealt with sexual immorality in the church and how that there were people not only condoning it, but saying that we were spiritually mature enough to accept that kind of thing. And Paul addressed that very seriously in saying that it was wrong. And we need to be aware of those things in the church so that we can be pure and holy before the Lord, because that is our desire, that is our aim, that we as individuals would be righteous before the Lord, that we would follow Him, seek Him with our whole hearts, and live pure and holy and undefiled before Him. And so in the context of church, there needs to be spiritual discipline on spiritual matters. And sin should not be swept under the rug. Sin should not be ignored. Sin should not be condoned. Sin should not be accepted. The Lord said, be holy for I am holy. And so that's our desire. And that's why we teach the Word of God. And that's why we hopefully learn from what is taught in the Scriptures. In this chapter now, Paul will be addressing the issue of Christians not handling their disputes with one another properly. Now, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I think that I could say that for all of us, we have at one point or another been in an argument or a disagreement, maybe even a very heated disagreement with another Christian. Maybe we didn't handle it properly. Maybe we got in the flesh. Maybe we said things that we shouldn't have been saying. Maybe it's happened between that other Christian in your life called your spouse. I don't know. Maybe the ones that you call children or friends or just somebody else that might go to the same church that you go to. So Paul's going to address the issue of Christians and their disputes. And furthermore, he's going to address the issue of them, the Christians, the body of Christ, having to rely upon spiritually unconcerned individuals or organizations that are non-Christian to work out their problems with their brothers or sisters in Christ. And so, point number one this morning as we begin in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 1 is keep it in house. Keep it in house. And Paul writes in verse 1 and says, "Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints?" Dare any of you go before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Well, unfortunately, church is comprised of people. And you might think, well, as opposed to what? Well, how about robots? See, people have emotions, opinions, issues, and problems, and some more than others. The people group that consider Vision City Church their home church. See, if there were any of us that were looking for the perfect church with no problems in it, we should not be allowed in, for we would ruin it. There is no perfect church. There's sinners in church, people that make mistakes and do things they shouldn't be doing. So the people in the church in Corinth were having problems with each other, and they were looking to secular leadership to arbitrate spiritual matters. They were looking, I find this ironic, they were looking for righteousness from those that were unrighteous before God. And the lawsuits, especially in Greek culture, they were entertaining. And they got a lot of news coverage. A lot of people that had nothing better to do would love to sit in the courts and be entertained by the latest lawsuit or disagreement or something that needed to be worked out with the judge. And Paul writes in the Greek language for that word, dare. He's like, dare you? He says, do you not dread or do you not shun with fear the fact that you are arguing as Christians in front of these people that are not? Have you brought yourself to, or are you so bold to do this kind of thing? What are you guys doing? Do you dare to bring your in-house matters before the public and the unrighteous at that? This is a very serious issue when it comes to the witness of the church. I mean, we've seen these things that have surfaced on the internet, on, you know, those blogs that, you know, they have the latest juicy gossip about whatever's happening in Christendom. You know, there's been those things that have been purposely posted on Facebook and in Twitter that should have been kept private, that those things should have been handled behind closed doors, and spiritual men should have worked out spiritual matters, and they should have done it for the glory of the Lord. There are things that have happened in church that should have been handled by the leadership and not in superior court. They should have been handled in house. Jesus, in Matthew chapter 18, instituted a three-step process for dealing with a Christian, dealing with another Christian. And he said, if somebody's offended you, number one, you should go to that brother or that sister. You go to them privately. You go to them personally. You don't hop on social media. You don't call and start gossiping about them. No, you go to the person that's offended you. And then he says, well, if they don't want to hear it from you, then bring in a neutral party. Somebody that's not emotionally charged, that can be able to mediate between you and your other brother or sister in Christ. And he says, if that doesn't work, then you bring in the leadership of the church that has been given spiritual oversight over the matters pertaining to those members of that church, those Christians. And then Jesus finally said, if at that point, after you've gone to that person, after you've brought in a neutral party that can mediate, and you've gone to the church with spiritual oversight, that you're to treat that person as a non-believer if they do not repent for what they have done. In Matthew chapter 5, I'll read this to you, verses 14 through 16, Jesus told his followers, he says, and his disciples there, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. See, the church is supposed to be the light in the world because the members of the church have the light of the world living inside them, Jesus. As he said in John 8, I am the light of the world. He tells his followers, you are the light that is going to shine. You are the ones that are going to be looked at to see what I'm all about. Nothing douses that light more than the church airing its dirty laundry before the world. See, when you handle things properly as Christians in a church, because you're going to have disagreements and you guys are going to butt heads and somebody may do something that offends you. See, when you are that light of the world working things out per the way that the Lord asked for us to work those things out, instructed us to, you give light to those that are in the house. Who's in the house? Your other brothers and sisters that attend the church. The way that you handle your problem with somebody else actually is an example to the rest of the people that are watching inside the church or that might know of it. It's also that city that's set on a hill, that the church, whether you like it or not, is going to attract attention. It is going to be, by the very nature of the way that God created it to be, that light that is going to shine. And when you see a light in darkness, you're attracted to that. You look at it. But all of a sudden, if the light that's supposed to be shining is not shining the way that it's supposed to be, then it causes people to question what that light is all about. And so the picture that's being painted here, or really what's being written to this church, is like, this is something that's bigger than you. This is something that is meant to represent God himself, the bride of Christ, the church. See, the Lord has appointed throughout history spiritual individuals to have oversight over the people of the Lord. You see it from cover to cover. In the Old Testament, you had the patriarchs. You had the judges. You had the prophets and you had the kings. In the New Testament, you had the apostles and the elders that are in the church. And that's why he says in verse 2, 1 Corinthians 6, he says, do you not know that saints will judge the world? And if the world will be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Do you not know that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? Revelation 20, verse 6 says, blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Speaking of you and me, those that death does not have power over. Those that have been resurrected into eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ. And the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that raises us from the dead. But this is a very interesting passage of Scripture talking about us reigning with Christ for 1,000 years. Listen to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 12. He says, if we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. And yes, that's a power-packed passage of Scripture, but let's just look at the first half there. We'll reign with him. Reign with him. And I think that this statement regarding judging angels is extremely fascinating. We'll have a very special place in the judgment of fallen angels. Now, I don't believe this will be a critique of God's angels, the ones that did not fall. This will not be us judging the messengers of the Lord because they ever live to serve him and to carry out his exact wishes. We're not going to be like, hey, you know what? I fell down and bumped my knee. Where were you, guardian angel? You don't check that box. That's not what this is going to be about. This does give us an interesting insight to our position with the Lord and our union with him. We are not the judge, but we will be a part of judging and ruling and reigning. Some of us like the idea of being Judge Judy, but I don't believe that it's going to be anything like that. However, with that point being made, how does this affect your view, my view, our view on how we should realize that we're completely capable of judging or arbitrating or mediating the problems within the church? That's what he's saying here. He says, do you not realize that there is going to be an appointed time where you will be reigning with Christ and you will be judging angels? Do you not think that you can handle the disputes that come up in the church? It would be almost rhetorical, this question, because you would hope that we'd be able to understand, yeah, the Lord gives us wisdom. The Lord gives us His word by which we can live life and where we can glean information on how to judge righteously and to do what is right. But listen to what James wrote in his letter in verses 1 through 3 of chapter 4. He says, and he's writing to the church, guys, you got to realize this, when he says, where do wars and fights come from among you? What? Christians fight? They war with each other? Christians say mean things and do wrong stuff to each other? He says, where do these wars and fights come from among you? And then he gives you the answer. He says, do they not come from your desire for pleasure that war in your members? He says, you lust and you do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. And then you ask and do not receive because you ask amiss that you may spend it on your pleasures. Let me just tell you something very, very simple. Every problem in the church, every single time, comes down to the flesh / sinful nature. Every single one. Every single problem that you will ever have in the body of Christ, with the church, with other Christians, is going to be narrowed down to one simple thing. It's not in the spirit. It's in the flesh. James gave us insight to it's more of like an entitlement. I want this. I deserve this. I need this. We need to walk in the spirit. If every problem, every argument you've had in your home, you can narrow it down, flesh. But they did this, but do two wrongs make a right? Are you going to stand before God and the Lord says, why did you speak so disrespectfully? And you're going to give the excuse because they spoke disrespectfully to me first. The Lord will say, I'm going to get to them. We're talking about you. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, Paul said, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. So anytime, whether you see it on Facebook, whether it's posted on some blog, or you experience it in the church, unfortunately, it is a reality, but you can narrow it down to the flesh. That's it. That's why point number 2 I've set up, and I think it goes well with the flow of the passage, is keep it in the Spirit. He says in verse 4, if then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? So, point number 1, keep it in-house. If you're dealing with something, don't air it. Be private about it. Be private about it. In families, you would call keep family business family business. Don't open the windows to the problem. Deal with the problem privately, personally, keep it in-house, and point number 2, keep it in the Spirit. What does God's word say? Am I in the flesh? Are you in the flesh? Are we led by the Holy Spirit, or are we led by our emotions or selfishness or whatever it might be? And again, verse 4, he says, if then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? So Paul says, you'll be ruling and reigning with Christ and judging angels. Can you not take care of your disputes? He says there in verse 4, the least esteemed. See, those that were least esteemed by the church were the pagan Corinthian judges that had no business dealing with spiritual affairs. Because let's face it, those that are esteemed by the church, and this is where we get this. If you ever heard anybody say this, it's because it's found in Acts chapter 6. Those that are esteemed by the church are those that are filled with the Holy Spirit, exercise wisdom, have good reputations, and walk humbly with their God. Those are the ones that we esteem in the church. Those are the ones that the Bible says are worthy to lead, that are worthy to serve. Those that are filled with the Spirit, have good reputations, and that exercise wisdom. And when you walk humbly before your God, God gives you grace. We shouldn't be looking to any other authority concerning spiritual matters than to the Word of God and to those who are spiritual. I hope that that just makes sense. Like, okay, that's common sense. If there's a spiritual issue with people that are spiritual, then it should be handled in a spiritual way. See, we in the church, we are wounded. We do make mistakes. We do, from time to time, do things that we ought not to be doing. But we need to work those things out with each other. I mean, I have to say this again because we live in the social media age. Don't go on Facebook and blast somebody publicly. Don't blast your ex-friend that you just unfriended. I mean, people are so demoralized. They unfriended me. They blocked me. My life is over. Or whatever it might be. Listen. Handle it in-house and in the Spirit. Don't gossip. Go to the person. Go to the person. I feel like too often we are too open with our opinions about certain things that we really should be keeping to ourselves. And see, we have the perfect outlet for it. We get on our keyboards and we start typing and we start writing these things, not realizing that words have power and words last, and especially when they're posted on the internet. In Matthew 18, verse 15, Jesus said, "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. And if he hears you, you have gained your brother." So when the church is handling their issues or problems in-house, you're keeping it in-house, what does Jesus say? He says, you gain your brother. And when you're not going before the public with this kind of stuff, what also is actually, might I say, maintained rather, is your witness. You have a problem in-house, you deal with it in-house, you go and deal with it the way the Lord says you're to deal with it, and you gain your brother, and you maintain your witness to the world. Because, let's face it, there are people outside the world that are trying, or they're just waiting for the Christian to blow it. They're waiting for the pastor to make a mistake. They're waiting for it. And the last thing we need to do is, you know, heap another log on the fire, so to speak, is to not deal with issues in the church in the manner that God tells us we should be dealing with them. Gain your brother. Maintain your witness. Don't do otherwise. In verse 5, Paul says, "I say this to your shame." It's embarrassing. "Is it so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one who will be able to judge between his brethren?" He says this to their shame. He's not saying, "Man, I am so proud of you guys, you can just get up in there and get ugly and shred those guys up in court." No, it's not. He's saying, what a shameful, terrible witness to the world when Christians are more aggressively cutthroat, slanderous, and venomous in dealing with others, especially with each other. This is embarrassing, guys. Why are we doing this? This isn't the example that the Lord would have us to set. You know, you've seen every single bumper sticker since they've invented bumper stickers in some way, shape, or form or font that said, "Christians aren't perfect, they're just forgiven." And I'm like, listen, we know we're not perfect. Sometimes we come across like, hey, I'm pretty much as close as it gets to perfect, and maybe you might be able to arrive, you know, like me one day. Couldn't be anything further from the truth, but the point is that we are not perfect. We do make mistakes. But how you handle those mistakes speaks volumes to the world. How you handle those things. Don't condone sin. People may not like you because of it, because they think you're being too narrow and bigoted or whatever. Listen, the Bible says what is right and what is wrong. And if you want to, if you don't want to like me because I actually hold to a conviction, that's entirely up to you. That's between you and God. That's your decision. I understand that. You have that prerogative. But when it comes to us as the church, knowing that we're not perfect, we do make mistakes, and yes, God will forgive us, is not a license to continue in sin, nor is it an excuse to do things that are not pleasing to the Lord, especially dealing with problems. Too often, I've seen it even in the short amount of time that I've been in ministry, relatively speaking, been 10 or so years or whatever, where I've seen so many problems come and divisions and hurt and pain because people just didn't do what God said to do in His Word. Because, yeah, you make a mistake, but how do you handle it? Are you going to be better from it? Are you going to learn from it? Are you going to grow? Are you going to be mature? Are you going to seek to grow in maturity? Are you going to do what God says to do, or are you not? Because problems will arise, but our church's strength and our love and our commitment to the Lord should enable us and empower us to work things out in-house and in the Spirit. In verse 6, it says, but brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. They're seeing this, and this is the double whammy, if you will. Christians being terrible to each other and treating each other the way that the world treats one another, and fighting and being selfish and greedy and power hungry. Like, not only are you doing these things, which are wrong, you're doing them to your own family, and you're doing it before unbelievers that are supposed to be seeing a difference in the way that Christians live and treat each other. What's going on? As a society, we've become sue happy. We'll sue you for anything. I'm going to sue them and take everything they own. Everything, every last penny. I can't stand these guys. Why? What did they do? They took my parking spot for the church last Sunday. I've had it. Done. You know? This is emotional and, you know, spiritual distress. Punitive damages for sure for that or whatever it might be. And you're like, come on. What in the world? I'm gonna sue you for everything. I don't like your face. I'm suing you. Point number 3 is be the peace. So keep it in-house, keep it in the Spirit. Be the peace. P-E-A-C-E. Now, there are both parties represented in our last two verses that we're going to be looking at this morning in verses 7 and 8. The ones that were offended and the ones that did the offending. And in context, I think this should answer some questions that may have popped up in your mind already as you're thinking about legalities, you're thinking about Christians and dealing with each other, you're thinking maybe about the court systems. I think this is going to answer many of those questions that have popped up in your mind. Paul is addressing both parties. How? Well, we'll see that in a second, but remember, the ones that were offending people and the ones that were being offended in the church. He's addressing both of them and how they are symbiotically affecting each other in this entity known as the church. How they're both working at the same time and how what they do affects each other and then affects them and then goes back to them, and it's symbiotic, it's connected. He says, now therefore, verse 7, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. Stop right there. The very fact that members of the church, Christians, professing Christians, followers of Jesus, have chosen to go to court against each other means they have failed. Right there should be enough. If you have to go to court or you have chosen to go publicly with a problem that was internal, you have failed. Doesn't get any more clear than that. I feel like that smacks us right between the eyes in understanding how things need to be taken care of. They failed. They failed spiritually. Now, I don't know if you've noticed this or not, that when someone is in the flesh, they don't think clearly. When somebody is overrun by emotion, they don't think clearly. When we're in the flesh, it's impossible to please God. When you're in the flesh, and I think even for all intents and purposes today, we could just say that the flesh is the worst part of who you are. The worst part of who you are. The bad habits, the bad tempers, the bad language, the bad desires, the things that make up who the worst Garrett is, who the worst you are. The flesh, our sinful nature. And when I'm controlled by the lusts of my flesh, or I am not exercising self-control, if I'm not walking in the Spirit, then I'm not able to make a spiritual decision that honors the Lord. I will be going in the opposite direction because in my flesh, as Paul said, dwells no good thing. I know what I'm capable of. I know the things that I have done that are wrong, just like you do in your own life. And if it were not for the Lord in my life, I would have been destroyed. If it were not for the Lord in our lives, we would have been destroyed. Think of where we would have been at this point in life if we were even still alive, if it were not for the Lord changing us, forgiving us of our sins, helping us overcome addictions, lifestyles, just dealing with the collateral damage of poor choices that we've made over our lives. When I'm in the flesh, I'm not going to make a right decision. I'm going to be self-centered, like it was described in James. Where do wars and fights come from among you? It's talking about self-centeredness. I want to get what I need, what I want, what I deserve. Retribution! Whatever it might be. When someone is controlled by the Holy Spirit and exercising self-control, there is great power and wisdom. And I've noticed this in my own life because I'm a very passionate person. For most of you that do know me, I'm not very monotone. I believe in things strongly, and that can be good and that can be not good. But I've noticed in my own life that when I know that the Holy Spirit is in control of a situation that I feel like just unleashing on, or I feel like giving them a piece of my mind, that I have found that through that self-control, there is great power that the Lord gives. That the Holy Spirit, like, you don't have to raise your voice to know that you're serious. Like, you don't have to. That there is power that comes from the Holy Spirit for the man or the woman that is exercising those gifts of the Spirit because they're in tune with the Lord. And the wisdom that comes from that is mind-blowing. Even the wisdom in communicating a simple truth. Maybe you're instructing somebody or correcting somebody or dealing with a problem. That the Holy Spirit does this great work because you're not controlled by the lusts of the flesh. You're under the control of the Holy Spirit. However, when we're not walking in the Spirit, things get ugly. Now let's look at the person who's been wronged. This is the first one mentioned in verse 7. It says, why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? And right away you're like, that sounds messed up. Is this saying that I'm supposed to get ripped off and not do anything about it? And people can treat me like this and I'm not to say anything and they can do this and that and I'm not to use the things that are at my disposal? Well, listen. What is said in verse 7 is taken from the same word of God that Romans 14 is when it states that we're to obey the laws of the land and the governing authorities. There are legal issues that Christians have every right to avail themselves by, and there is nothing against God for doing so. What this is saying is that it is better to preserve your witness and personal testimony before the world than to fight for your rights with other Christians before the world. Because it should have gone all the way back to the beginning. Keep it in-house. Keep it in the Spirit. Be the peace. It is better to preserve the testimony of the Christian, which is the light of the world pointing to the light of the world, than to argue for what you may deserve. This is not saying that Christians cannot be involved with certain legalities in non-Christian court systems. This is not saying that. We can, and as unfortunate as it is, if you've ever been involved with legal issues, they're not fun to deal with on the winning or losing side. They're draining, and it's just, you don't want to do that. But there are certain cases where it's absolutely okay and necessary for a Christian to be involved with those things. But what he's saying here is you're dealing with your other brothers and sisters in Christ. Which means that if this is allowed or it's continuing, it's because one of you, if not both of you, are in the flesh. Meaning that someone is doing something that is not right. And that, logically, is wrong. It's wrong before the Lord. It's wrong before the world in your testimony. This is saying that you should not be fighting amongst yourselves in the public eye. Now, the second party that's mentioned here is in verse 8. And this is the one who's offended. He says, so let's read 7 and 8 together in context. Now therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourself be cheated? And you think, well, how does that even flow? Well, listen, the symbiotic relationship is here. In verse 8, he says, no, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do these things to your brethren. Either way you look at it, it's wrong. Either way, you have the power to correct it regardless of what the other person's doing. If you're doing these things that are hurting people, that are wronging people, you might think you'll get away with it here. Maybe you think, oh, they're not going to take me to court over this. Listen, you're not escaping Almighty God. You're not escaping the judge of all the world. And you're going to give an account for what you've done. For the person that's doing those kind of things in church, and somebody's gone to them personally and privately, and you didn't want to listen to them. They brought in a mediator who is neutral to both of your positions, and you didn't want to listen to them either. And then finally, because you're going to church and you're professing yourself to be a Christian, professing that you're a Christian, they go to the spiritual authority in your church, and you still don't want anything to do with it, and you don't receive it from the person you've offended, from the neutral party or from the church. The Bible says, Jesus said himself, you're to be treated as a non-Christian. Don't call yourself a Christian. That's extremely serious. If you're going to continue down that path, wronging people, offending people, hurting people, and doing things that have been addressed personally, that have been addressed with a neutral party and with the church, then you're in a bad spot. Repent. Turn from those things. Be welcomed back into the family of God. But I hope that you see the big picture here is that life is short. Jesus said, you're the light of the world. And when we argue and when we fight and when we're mean and cruel to each other, when we're in the flesh and we're doing things that we ought not to be doing, it's destroying the witness of our Savior. It's destroying the very purpose for which the church was established. For the preaching of the gospel, from bringing glory to God. People end up cursing the Lord, and the name of the Lord becomes something that's a byword, that they look at it and they're going, why do I even need Jesus? What is this church all about? They're more messed up than we are. It ought not to be. So, this morning, as we conclude, This should be, hopefully, a very sobering reminder for some of us that are familiar with this passage. For others, and I think just our church in general, it should instruct us on what to do and what not to do when it comes to dealing with disputes that we might have that may arise with other Christians in the church. Because quite frankly, here's the deal. If somebody comes up to you and says, you know what so-and-so did? They're just the biggest jerk and blah, 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 and all this kind of stuff to you. You just grab them by the arm and say, okay, I'm going to walk you over to that person right now. And you're going to tell them what you just told me. Point people where they need to be going. Point people in the right direction. Don't be like when the person comes up to you and starts saying those things. Really? Tell me more. Oh, man. You don't say. Well, what happened next? Wait a second. I got to tell my friend about this real quick. Hold on. And don't do that. If you have been offended, go to that person. Go to them privately. Go with them in love. The Bible says you work it out. You gain your brother. You maintain your witness. Job well done. So don't be caught off guard if disputes arrive or if something happens. Some of us get more offended than others. That's our personality. That's what happens. We all have different personalities. But it's how we deal with it is what's going to speak volumes to the people in the church, gives light to all who are in the house, and to those that are outside the church, because we're that city that's set on a hill, and it gives light out. And we want that light to be pure and holy so that the world might know who Jesus is, and they'll know us by our love that we are Christians. So let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. We ask, God, that you would continue to give us wisdom and discernment, Lord, that we really need. We need that wisdom and how to deal with certain problems that may arise. I thank you, Lord, that we're able to learn, in this case, from the Corinthians on what not to do. And I ask that you would help us to not repeat the mistakes of those that have gone before us. I ask, Lord, that you would help us to walk in the Spirit so that we're not fulfilling the lusts of the flesh. And Lord, if we're in an argument with somebody, I ask, Lord, that you would help us to ask ourselves the honest question, am I in the flesh or am I in the Spirit? We do know, Lord, that your word tells us that the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. And so, Lord, I pray that if we're losing our tempers, if we are getting emotionally, Lord, overrun, that, Lord, we would recognize those things and that we'd be able to make wise decisions that are led by the Holy Spirit and that we'd be able to work out anything that's needed to be worked out. And Lord, I ask, God, that you would please give us grace in our church. Lord, I pray, Lord, that there wouldn't be anything that would have to escalate itself, Lord, to going to a court system. I pray, Lord, that we would live pure and holy before you. I pray, God, that you would help us to have good reputations. And Lord, that we'd be filled with your Holy Spirit and that we would exercise wisdom in the way that we conduct our lives. And Lord, we ask that you would do these things. We ask for all of these things in the name of Jesus. And we all say together, amen.